What?
Here's Brunet. Brunet's in. Andrew Brunet shot. Score! Andrew Brunet in sudden death overtime. And Minnesota is moving on.
I won't need my high school diploma anymore. I am the smart. I am the smart. I am the smart. I am the smart. S-M-R-T. I mean S-M-A-R-R-T.
Played here by Danny Heatley, and out they come 2-on-1. This is Niederreiter holding onto it, and he scores! Nino Niederreiter wins the series for the Minnesota Wild.
Welcome to another edition of the Giles and the Goalies podcast. We're here with the full complement of goalies, surprisingly enough to us, actually. Joined by Charlie this week, who may or may not have been able to make it here, but he ended up making here. So thanks for making it to your own podcast, Charlie.
Yeah. Well, like I said when I came in, I just wanted to be the special guest on my own podcast. One time. I was right up the road. I thought you guys were going to be going to like 7:30. It turned into 9:30, and I was like, yeah, I can make that. I was 5 minutes away.
Okay, tell the truth. Where did you really fly in from to be here?
Roseville High School. Yeah. Not nearly as cool.
Is this isn't like the private jet from
Hattiesburg. I had a good lie training? For when I post the podcast tomorrow, too. I was going to say I was fulfilling my dream of becoming a riverboat captain, and now I don't even get to use that. I've had to come up with creative absences.
that's true.
All right. I'm not even the most interesting guy here. Let's move on.
On that note, the namesake himself, Giles, what's going on today, Giles?
I'm enjoying a cold beverage, which
is that all?
We know. Is
that all you're doing?
It's a sex on the beach, isn't it?
No. So, last night, I had to cut myself off from Twitter because of the negativity.
It's fair.
And don't get me wrong, last night's game was an atrocity. But good Lord, it's as if... I don't even know what to say. It was a dumpster fire.
Yeah.
It drove me up a tree. Mainly because it's the night started with everyone still complaining about how to pronounce Mikhail Granlund. And... It's
Greenland.
He literally...
like Greenbelt.
He literally said he does not care, so neither should we. But yet everyone else has taken it upon themselves to care. Stop caring. Thank you.
All right.
How many people have called you Giles Farrell over the course of your life? That's all I'm saying. Yeah. I wrote about this after game one.
The number of variations of how my name has been pronounced over the years is uncountable.
Right. Yeah.
And then we got these two guys.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe you get once in a while you get a Ben Remington.
Not really, no.
No?
No.
Okay.
And so, yeah, on that note, somebody with a pretty much pronounceable across-the-board name, our special guest, Wild Extra writer, our Sunday wordsmith himself,
noted
Jared Mason.
Noted pants burglar.
Yeah, noted pants burglar and wordsmith, Jared Mason. What's up, Jared?
Hi, guys. You'd think it'd be quite easy to get my name right, but I get everything.
Really?
People don't even know my name. My last name is Mason, and they call me Jason. They just put them together. I get that a lot. What's the worst part? The worst part is, like, I'm turning 35 this year. And people approach me and like, oh, he went to Jared or like the subway guy, right?
Oh,
like,
God.
35 years old. You really think I haven't heard that before? It's like people think they're so clever when they're like, oh, and then they're like, they see it and they see my eyes and they go, oh, sorry.
Well,
so, I'm getting a lot of those looks today, at the office because, you know, I'm sure we all can relate. Being known as the resident Wild follower,
right?
And then people, don't you hate it? Like, people come up to you after a loss like that. They're like, I'm sorry. Like, what the hell are you sorry about? I don't want to hear about it.
Yeah.
Now you're making me mad.
Actually, go away.
What grinds my gears more is when people come up to you on game day, and then they ask you, so the Wild going to win tonight? And then I just look, and in my head I'm just going, how the f*** do I know? Who cares?
We're just throwing the PG rating of the show right out the window for this episode, folks. I don't know if you guys heard.
I think that's my fault.
I've got a bleep sound effect. We can just edit that in later.
you should just throw it in random places.
We'll just hit it at random.
The guy really horrible at the sensor button.
Yeah, that's me. I'm on the sensor button, so that's not good. Anyway, speaking of obscene amounts of obscenities, game two happened last night, and it was a complete F, basically, is what it comes down to.
Beep.
Yeah, it was a complete. Yeah. So 4-1 Chicago, and you know maybe it was a little bit closer than the score indicates. The shots were obviously not that far apart, and there was, you know, a decent amount of puck luck in the Blackhawks' favor, but still, you know, plenty of mental breakdowns by the Wild. Not really, Dubnyk was good, but didn't obviously steal the show. So what are your guys' thoughts coming out of game two?
I'm going to go back to old adage town here.
If
anybody was on Twitter today and saw what the San Diego Padres did with their keys to the game against the Rockies, which I'll explain.
That was the best thing I've ever seen.
But this is straight out of that school. It's that if you give the team's three best goal scorers really high-quality chances, you're gonna lose. That's my instant analysis of game
two. Every time.
So that's about it.
Yeah.
Mic drop.
Yeah.
Okay, side question to that. Since we all know who the Blackhawks' three top goal scorers are, who would you guys say the Wild's three top goal scorers are, since they just really spread the wealth on this team?
Well, it was Parise, Nino, and Zucker this year, wasn't it? Was the top three?
Vanek.
Didn't Zucker end up with more, or no, it was Vanek?
I think Vanek and Zucker both ended up with 21.
Okay. Yeah. Sure.
Pominville is right up there, too. He's just so quiet.
Yeah, he had 18, but...
He's quiet about getting up there in points because he gets so many opportunities, and most of them leave you F-bombing. but then you just don't realize that he's still getting, you know, apples, and he's still getting, goals, too.
Yeah.
I couldn't think of anything clever for a G-word, so I just said goals.
That's fine.
That's what I meant.
Grapefruits. I don't think we want... That's more 5-minute major territory. You're talking about grapefruits, actually. So,
well, you're not talking about, you know.
We'll stray away from tugging. There's enough of that talk on this website.
A lot of tugging going on.
A lot of tugging. A whole lot of tugging.
Tugboat captain.
Can that be Doubles' new nickname? Doubles the tugboat captain. All right. Well, so this is a lot of inside humor that hopefully our fans
get. Next time you do a Follow Friday, Ben, you can now refer to Doubles as the tugboat captain.
Referee/tugboat captain, Doubles.
Toot.
Anyway, so, you know.
Can we at least get him a hat?
So the Wild are down 2-0, but, you know, they've been here before, and last year they won the Colorado series after falling down 2-0, and then they fell down 2-0 to the Blackhawks last year. Ended up losing in 6 games, but, you know, it was a lot closer than that, seeing as how they lost in overtime. So how concerned are we, I guess I should put it? Because
this is the exact same series it was last year.
Yeah.
Game 2 last year was a disaster in Chicago.
Right.
It was an afternoon game. They lost, I think, like 3-0 or something like that.
Sure. Yeah, it wasn't close.
I'm not sure what the final score exactly was. Then the Wild won the next 2 games, and all the talk after winning the 2 home games was Chicago's tired. They've been playing too many playoff games.
Right,
the Wild actually have a shot to win this. And they really did.
Yeah.
They had a legit shot to win
game
5 and an even more legit shot to win game 6. So, like Giles, I think, said on Twitter, and it's kind of a hockey-accepted adage in the playoffs, you're not in trouble until you lose at home.
Yep.
Well, the Wild haven't lost at home yet.
Right.
So it's bad. You don't want to be down 2-0, but it's not, like, Armageddon bad.
Right.
No.
And I think that's, you know, a good point, because I just looked at it today in the stats where – but coming into this year, teams up 2-0 win 86% of the series. It's like, well, that's also including the sweeps and the 5-gamers, that there really isn't any competition.
No chance,
there. Yeah, I mean, that's, you know, that's including your Rangers over your Penguins, where there never was really a whole lot of hope, or even your Anaheim over the Jets, which, you know, was a lot closer than the sweep would indicate, but was still a sweep. So I think that it's not, you know, I don't know that the Wild are at a 14% chance, you know, dire situation here.
Well, you guys mentioned, you know, last year and how it's very similar to a couple series that played out for us last year. But
Even more recently, we responded to the St. Louis Blues by so we're going home for two games. We responded to the St. Louis Blues by winning at home and in St. Louis in order to win the series. So, or the other way around, to win the series at home. In theory, that's a lot harder to win two games, you know, home and away. And we've got a good opportunity to bring it home where everyone's going to be, you know, real jacked. The people who should be most jacked are the Wild. Because if they come out like they did in the last game and even in game one, especially game one, if they don't take game three, they are not long for.
That's kind of the precipice that they're on. It's being down 2-0 is fine if you're going home and you've got two games coming up. We've seen that happen obviously with this team before, but you lose that third game and then you're facing the vaunted 3-0 deficit and it's not good from there. I mean it's obviously it's only happened what 4 times I believe. And just happened last year, so...
Yeah, you're not playing the Sharks. Right. These are the Blackhawks.
Yeah, it's a totally different team. This isn't the dumpster fire Sharks that we saw last year in the playoffs. But I'm encouraged that they're going home because I kind of added it up on my way here. They're 3-9 on the road over the last two seasons, but they're 7-2 at home.
In the playoffs.
And those two losses, we have lost one... hashtag stanchion game where it's like you lose in overtime to
and what was the other one?
The other one should probably be stricken from the record. And honestly I
it was a good contest for like 3-4 minutes.
Yeah, I think you can kind of write that one off a little bit. I mean not that you definitely should, but that game was so far away from anything that we've seen from the Wild, anything that we saw from the Blues the rest of the series, for that matter.
Well, so was last night. I mean, the Wild have not played like that for a while. They played poorly last night.
So, I mean, you can't strike Game 4 of the Blues series from the record, but that was only their second playoff loss in, what will be three full series, basically. And now they're going home for two games, and, as dire as down 2-0 is, you got to be encouraged by that.
Well, it's one of those things where getting back to the negativity that we all saw last night.
I was one of them.
And it's always in the Twitter universe because that's where we all are during games.
Yep.
But, I mean, it extends to people who aren't on Twitter. It extends to people who are watching at home. It extends to people who are going to be going to Game 3.
Yep.
And it's one of those things, and I don't know if this is true of other fan bases, but I really think it's true of all Minnesota fan bases, is that when things are going great, everybody's fine. Everybody's really pumped up.
Yeah.
But and they're not jumping off the bandwagon necessarily, as they're protecting themselves from like emotional ruin.
Yeah.
So they get out early just to say like, I was never really that into it. I knew this was going to happen. And it's just stay with it. No, you're not an idiot if you follow a team all the way to the fourth loss.
Right.
Against a really good Chicago team. Yeah.
There are two main culprits to thank for that self-protection.
I think I know who they
oneself are. When it comes to Minnesota sports. The first are the Vikings.
There we go. That's one.
The second.
Is that football?
No, the History Channel show.
I love that show.
It's a good show.
I'm a big fan of that team.
They're good. Better than the actual football.
Right, right.
It was football. You lied to me.
Yeah.
And then the second is Norm Green.
Well,
well, I'll just leave it at that before I add more expletives. I think that's kind of why we all guard ourselves against losing.
Yeah, I think that's just kind of the ballot of the Minnesota sports fan, really. It's easy for them to not get too high, and it's very easy for them to bail on a situation where it looks like the team is going to lose because, quite frankly, that's where we've been at. I mean, 24 years after a World Series, 24 years after a World Series title right now,
24.
And only two of those and, only two professional sports titles in, since the dawn of time, essentially, unless you count Minneapolis Lakers 60, 70 years ago.
I do. The Lynx.
Yeah, I'm sure you do. Yeah, the Lynx. Okay, men's professional sports, sorry.
Let's be fair.
Yeah, equal time. I mean, it's easy not to blame people for behaving that way. It doesn't make it right, but at least you understand where they're coming from, and I think everybody feels that pain, and even this team itself. You know, it's not a whole lot of knife twisting when it comes to this team and this team's history, but even this team itself has given fans in 15 years a fair share of disappointment.
And I think what bothers me the most is that a lot of people go from, this is a really good team, to, yeah, this team was always awful, and
yes,
I always knew it. And
yeah,
it's one of those things where it's like, this is part of the deal. I mean, this is a really good, this is the best Wild team that they've ever had.
Yeah.
I think we can all agree on that,
yeah,
talent-wise.
Yeah.
I don't know if they got more points than, I think they might have finished with a 102 one that,
in
that
2007.
Other year. Yeah, so they did break 100. But also, they're playing in the best conference. You know, they're playing in the best division in the best conference.
Right.
You're talking about a division where every team over the last 2 years has made the playoffs.
Yeah.
Every team.
Yep.
And then on top of that, you throw in Anaheim, and the Kings didn't even make the playoffs.
Right.
Nobody wants to play those guys ever again. Probably the Sharks, too. That's not a bad hockey team. It's just they're kind of a messy hockey team. But, I mean, as good as it was going to be for the Wild, if they lose the series, it's not a failure.
No.
It's not a failure. It's you lost to another good team.
Yeah.
Even if you get swept. Unfortunately, you got swept. You didn't play as well as you could have. But it's not like you lost to the Oilers.
Right.
No.
Yeah, and that was the point. I wrote that the famous Debbie Downer article 2 days before the series started, and that was kind of my central point. And I didn't want to, you know, be that guy, be like, see, I called it. I knew the Blackhawks were going to win the series. I said that in the article. I said I thought the Wild could win the series, given the what we saw to the Blackhawks in the first round. But at the same time, I said it's very possible that the Wild lose this series. Very possible. And at that point, you don't want to overreact. I mean, there's a whole lot of overreaction theater out there, especially on the internet, because that's the internet. That's what it's for.
I don't get it.
But, yeah, I just felt like, you know, fans don't need to go crazy. I mean, I'm not joking. I saw two serious Fire Yo tweets last night. And it's just like, I don't.
We all collectively put our heads on the table.
Yeah, I don't even know where to go with that. I mean,
so,
you know, so it just, that's the kind of stuff that I was writing against, I'll say, in that article. So it just, level heads need to prevail.
Follow-up question. If the Wild do come back and win this series, will you write a I'm so happy to be proven wrong post?
No. No, I mean.
haven't we all already done that, you know, plenty this
yeah,
season?
That's,
I know I have.
I haven't written my I'm sorry for writing about Paul McClain post.
But yours was well-written. I think that's where we're getting
that's
at.
That's true, yeah. That's true. No, you know, I actually didn't have, I never really had a Fire Yo post. I didn't have a whole lot of doom and gloom posts. Even when it was at its worst, I was.
I don't think we ever had a Fire Yo post.
We had one. Berg
Mike
did
Berg.
One.
Oh, did he? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Berg did Berg, one.
Berg
and then,
I covered the gamut there. I said we're not going to make the playoffs. Berg said Fire Yo. We both
apologized. And then we famously ran over coaching candidates for a week, but which was understandable because we prefaced that with saying that Yo shouldn't be fired, and then, you know, we wrote about candidates.
And at the time, right. at least the not making the playoffs thing was a good point.
Yeah.
It wasn't a...
Because
well,
it was a
yeah,
long shot at
last
best.
Place,
yeah.
8
oh, right.
points behind
yeah.
7th or 6th. Yeah, I guess the whole way I took the series of articles we wrote about... I don't even know why we're talking about this still, but the series of articles we wrote about Yo and his job in January, it was early January, late December, was...
Mm-hmm.
You know, he might get fired.
Right.
And this is what's out there if he gets fired.
No, that's exactly
and
how
honestly,
we
phrased
it
was pretty
too.
Underwhelming.
Right.
So.
And that was kind of our point was.
Somebody call Mike Keenan.
Yeah,
get
exactly.
him back from. Get Mark Crawford back from Switzerland.
I'd like to say that I didn't write a Fire Yo post because my knowledge of hockey knows no bounds. But I just. I don't know. I don't know that I can even brag about that because it's like. You just want to be level-headed, you know. You just want to, be on an even keel, and I think we've done a good job of that. And people just need to continue that.
Mike Keenan would have pulled Doobie in
he would have.
Game 4.
He would have.
I don't know if it's going to pick up on the podcast, but Ben is really hammering on the table when he said that.
I think it will.
Like our own little podcast cruise chef over here.
Say, yeah.
Hopefully I didn't dislodge any kind of important wiring that we've got going on here.
I have to come back to this bar, Ben. Don't make me pay for a new table.
All right, so yeah, I mean, that was game two. It was ugly. It was ugly by pretty much every definition of the word.
The frightening thing for me about game two was that game one we saw Chicago, what Chicago can do.
Right.
We also saw them make mistakes.
Yeah.
Game two, they didn't make any mistakes.
No, they didn't.
And the Wild didn't make a whole lot of mistakes, but they made enough mistakes for Chicago to take advantage. And that's what we're looking at. I mean, if they can adapt and if they can improve where they needed to, and it's only game two, then that's what we could be looking at for the rest of the series.
Yeah. No, I think that's fair. Do you guys have any thoughts on game one in a vacuum? Or?
I'm just going to say, for those of you, if you want to fire Yo, you better hope that either Mike Babcock somehow doesn't go back to Detroit or doesn't end up in Toronto by the end of the playoffs, or Joel Quenneville somehow gets fired out of Chicago.
Yeah.
Because if you don't get one of those two guys, you're not upgrading.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying that, like, Mike Yeo is the third best coach in the league. I'm saying there's Mike Babcock, Joel Quenneville, and everybody else.
Pretty much, yeah.
That's fair.
I mean, unless you can find a way to rein in the ghost of Pat Quinn or something, Scotty Bowman, is he still coaching somewhere?
He's still with us.
He's still alive, but he's not, he's long retired. So, yeah, I'm with you on that. So, it's just pump the brakes, that's all. That's all we're saying. Just pump the brakes. Even if this team loses,
and
Gordon
Bombay isn't available either.
Is he back working at Duxworth and Associates?
Just stop it.
He made my own joke.
it went south ever since he picked up that second DUI.
Yeah, that's true.
He didn't get off with a cute coaching assignment this time. It was.
Yeah. He ended up having to coach the hockey jail team.
That's right.
It was like the longest.
It was the longest yard.
Yeah.
What would they call that movie? The longest.
Longest neutral
shot
zone.
D cell block 4 is what it's called.
Wow.
All right. Well, we tangented on
dark.
Fourth sequel of the Mighty Ducks.
Getting dark.
This conversation is devolving quickly.
Prison style.
So, other than that, I guess we can just kind of shift into the playoffs as a whole. Kind of interesting the way things have gone down in a couple of series. Maybe a little bit on the predictable side, but interesting in the fact that it is going kind of predictably. I mean, you certainly expected the Lightning to, put up a good showing against Montreal, and, hey, they won two games in Montreal. The Ducks, obviously, were going to be heavily favored against the Flames, and they're smoking the Flames. No pun intended. And then the Caps and the Rangers, I think a lot of people did expect that to be a pretty good series. And, they're playing right now, and it was 1-1 going into this game. So what do you guys think about the playoffs as a whole? Do you have any observations on that?
Do you think there are podcasters in Montreal having the same conversation we're having about being down 2-0? The answer is no, because they're having the same conversation in French.
Yeah. Well, they're also down 2-0.
It's a bilingual bloodbath is what it is. And
right.
They
a little worse.
They're also really frustrated because they haven't scored in 4 years.
Yeah, that's
but that's true.
I haven't seen much of the Washington-New York series because it keeps
really
being on while I'm working. But,
right.
I have seen the Calgary. Oh, I was at a 5-year-old's birthday party for that one, so that's good. I got the
nice.
I got a temporary Donald Duck tattoo on my bicep to show it too. Every word of that is true. It's starting to peel away. Anyway, but I have seen a lot of the Anaheim-Calgary series, and watching those teams play right now,
oh man!
The only comparison I can make is the quarterfinals of the state tournament in Class A, when you've got like Section 1 going up against
top team.
Rec,
right.
Or St. Thomas from 5 years ago, or now it's East Grand Forks or Hermantown.
Right.
And it's just like, or what are the shots in that series? Like 45-10 in each game? It's brutal.
The goal differential is 9-1.
Yeah. But just like in the state tournament, it's like the lower seeded team just has a hot goalie, like Kerry Ramo.
There,
and he stands on his head and still loses 3-0.
Right. They're just happy to be there. That's how they're feeling. Kind of like the Jets in round one. the Flames are very much happy to be in round two, and that's about it.
Well, I think what happened is that what everyone wanted to happen in the first round between Vancouver and Calgary, both teams literally killed each other.
Yeah.
And there's nothing left in Calgary, and nobody's all that broken up about it, except for the fact that they're playing the Ducklocks. So.
Yeah, I think the Flames, they didn't have quite the happy-to-be-there feel that the Jets did. I mean, obviously the Jets are the first playoffs back in Winnipeg, so that's why. You know, but the Flames, I think that their focus really was going into the playoffs, beating Vancouver.
Yeah.
And mission accomplished.
Yeah.
And now they're up against what's obviously a vastly superior team. And, you know, they don't have anything left in the emotional gas tank. And they didn't, even if they did, they wouldn't really stand much of a chance against the Ducks anyway.
I really just want to see somebody in Calgary when they go back for games three or four, probably game four when they're about to get swept, just be like, joke's on you, we weren't even supposed to be here.
Right, yeah.
What's going on, LA Kings?
Exactly. Yeah. We're one of the final eight teams. I mean, they were picked by a lot of people to finish, you know, what, bottom five? I mean, there was a lot of talk of them being in the McDavid sweepstakes when the season began.
And that team's getting better, too.
Right,
I mean,
right.
Remember, they're doing all this with their best player, Mark Giordano. And they've got prospects coming up. I mean, Johnny Gaudreau is just scratching the surface of what he can do. Same with Monahan, and he scored 30 goals.
He's only scratching the surface because he's so short. I
The surface is about 6 feet in the air, and he has to reach.
Short guy jokes.
Yeah. That's fair.
That's all I had.
It's not. It's about as unfair as it gets.
Yeah. Well, you know.
Short guy jokes.
Yeah, it's fair to call him short, I guess, is what I meant. Anyway, so.
He's so short. Did everyone understand that? Let's go back. He's so short, he's shorter than the surface. That's why it was funny.
That's why he's only scratching it.
Just want everybody to know this is one beer in for Mason. So it gets better.
Not even a full beer.
Oh, here. Sorry, here.
Which is why I regret missing the Wild support group party for game one. Cause
we can talk on that since only me and Mason were there. But, that turned out to be a pretty good time for game one.
You just called them out.
A little bit, yeah. I've done a lot of shaming on these guys for not showing up. So.
The day of, he actually said he hated us.
I did.
So this isn't the worst thing
he said. I said, come to the Wild X reviewing party. If you don't, you're stupid and I hate you. Comma, Giles Farrell and Charlie.
To be fair, I had to prep for that 5-year-old's birthday party on Saturday by traveling 90 miles.
Oh, yeah. I was going to say you had to go to bed early and rest up
for
it.
You're shaving the area that you were going to get that tattoo? Donald Duck tattoo?
Shaving the area for the Donald Duck tattoo. No, that was it turned out pretty well. I mean, I actually only made half of the party. I showed up about halfway through the second period, so I was at the nearby Twins game that night. It was, you know, we packed up the front room at Mason's pretty well, and there was lots of lemon-flavored alcohol consumed and lemon bars consumed and free beer. So it was definitely a good time.
In true form, we you know, people who don't understand the meaning of Wild Support Group and the lemon bars, they're like, cool, lemon bars, let me have one. I'm like, no, not yet. Just wait. It's going to happen.
Give it a few minutes.
Wait until we're behind. It will happen.
No. It took about halfway through the third period, and all the lemon bars were gone.
I first started handing them out and freaking people, like just really creeping guys out when it was 2-0. I was like, give me the plate, John. And then I went around, and I realized how awkward it would be because here's this stranger with the name tag that says Pants Burglar on it, and he's offering everyone, men and women, unwrapped food on a plate.
That was clearly not prepared in that bar that you're eating at.
No, and, I mean, there's powdered sugar on it. Maybe it's powdered sugar. I was like, why am I getting so many? That's why I'm getting weird looks. I was like, take the lemon bar.
To be fair, you probably couldn't have picked a worse way to describe that entire scenario. I just picture somebody who, stumbled across this podcast only 10 seconds ago.
Yeah.
And just, to, like, they walked into the room and somebody else was listening, and they just heard that story.
Well,
that's a slow back out, is what that is.
What equally confusing would be people who just stumbled into Mason's bar on Friday night and was like, hey,
right,
why are all these people wearing name tags?
It's not like it's an out-of-the-way place, you know,
no,
right downtown.
No, it's dead center on...
To be fair,
very close to Target Field, and their Twins were playing.
Yeah,
John has a party there about once a month, so it's not out of the norm for Masons.
And for, you know, for somebody who wasn't there, thank you to all the people that did show up.
Yeah,
all
yeah,
the
absolutely.
Fans that did show up, and hopefully we will do stuff like that again.
Yeah.
If the playoffs are going on, hopefully,
sure.
while
yeah.
the playoffs are
hopefully
going on.
Hopefully another one soon.
I don't think we can throw one together before tomorrow night. But
no, I don't think so.
That should be the first of many Wild Extra, Wild Support Group parties, and so good to see so many people got to the first one.
Yeah, yeah, it was great. It was a good time, and we had a pretty good showing. And you know, the game obviously didn't turn out how we'd like, but it was nice that you know the team went down 3-0 and came all the way back with everyone there. And
yeah, I think John put it very well in the piece that he wrote for about it. Being there for the team, you know, reaching down and not tugging anything and getting down behind 0-3, but then coming back and everyone being around for that comeback too.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Yep. So that was successful. Very successful. All right. So looking into game three, then, you know, there's a lot of things that are out there as far as questions that I think need to be answered, and you know, one of the bigger ones is goaltending on both sides. We can get into Dubnyk in a little bit, but I think the real, you know, one question that I think is valid is Corey Crawford. Not that I think that is, you know, not that I think that he's in any kind of, you know, trouble or that it's going to affect his play a whole lot, but he got his bell seriously rung last night, and to the point where it broke the metal cage on his mask, and he had to switch masks via Marco Scandella's slapshot. Charlie, you wrote about this today, you know, and how there isn't a real protocol for goalies when they get hit like that, but as you and I can tell anybody, when you get hit square in the face with a slapshot, it's not a tickling sensation, exactly.
No, not really. And my point was, I mean, there is a protocol for goalies. There should be.
Well, right, there
it should be the same protocol for goalies.
There's a protocol for players, but not for goalies.
And that's where it gets really tricky because, I mean, you talk about the choir room. The choir room is, I think it's 10 minutes, is it not? And that's a long time to be gone for a goalie, and you don't want to be switching goalies back and forth. I understand that. But these guys, I don't know if they're necessarily more at risk than other players, but they're certainly at risk. They've got people flying into them. They've got pucks flying into them.
I don't think that goalies have gotten as many concussions as forwards, but it's definitely not something that never happens. You know,
I mean,
it's definitely something that's a possibility.
I'm not a professional. I've had one concussion in my life. It came from playing hockey goalie.
Right.
And it wasn't from a puck. It was from a player.
Sure.
Skating, it was one of my own teammates, skating by, and he clipped the side of my head with his hip.
Darcy Kemper.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, this happens a lot.
He got Kempered.
And the thing of tying it back to kind of what happened to Crawford is that I got a concussion, but I didn't know I had that concussion for 2 days.
Yeah.
And in the meantime, I actually rode a roller coaster or two.
Oh, God.
So
it's like a bad movie.
It's a really dumb story. And that's absolutely true. So. And then I couldn't do anything for a month. But it's one of those things where it's like not all concussions are immediate.
Right.
Exactly.
So if the reason why you have the choir room is to go back there and check for any signs that there might be something going on.
Right.
So you can get a guy out of there if he has that kind of latent symptom thing like I did. And so, like you said just now, and I said in the article too, I don't think he actually had a concussion.
Right.
I was watching him the rest of the game. He was moving around just fine. He wasn't slow. But that's not the point. The point is you have this protocol. You're supposed to follow it, and you're not supposed to pick and choose when you follow it.
Right,
and
they're basically really making an exception for goalies is what they're doing. I mean,
really
you know, when you think about it, I mean, the dude's mask broke.
They didn't even check him out.
Right.
Basically, he went over to the bench. The trainer was like, "You good?" And he's like, "Yeah, I'm good." And that was it. So
because I've had a slap shot dent the stainless steel cage over my mask, you know, hitting me head on, basically exactly what happened to him. And it didn't break it; it just dented the steel. But I didn't get a concussion from that either. But I mean, I was standing up straight, and it almost knocked me over backwards in goalie skates, which are, you know, like mini skis almost. They're so long, but that's how hard it hit, and it dented a stainless steel mask. You know, if it's to the point where it broke his mask, I mean, that's pretty serious stuff. And you know, obviously, there's a lot of questions as to what what exactly they do. Will they put Darling in the game and wait, you know, or and then Crawford can come back? Or, but I think that is something that, you know, needs to be addressed.
It's not even the fact that his mask broke, because
right.
that can happen and a guy's fine.
Sure, yeah.
It's the fact that when he got back up,
yeah,
his knees legs, wobbled.
Yeah, his legs
very visibly.
Clearly jelly.
I mean, the last time you saw that, it was like when, you know, Paul Kariya got drilled in the playoffs
yeah.
and tries to get up and skate off, and his legs go like eight different directions.
Yeah.
I mean, those are horrible videos to watch. This one wasn't as graphic. I mean, he steadied himself pretty quickly, but anytime you see that, you need to check a guy out.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it was obvious to see even in real time as it happened that he was reacting poorly to that impact. And, you know, I mean, he looked like, you know, in Mortal Kombat when you're supposed to finish the guy and you're just like, you're wagging it back and forth.
Woozy.
And then, yeah, you scorpion the shot of him.
But, yeah.
And the fact that, like, it was so visible to anybody who was watching, and they didn't do anything. You're right. I mean, like, the fact that they didn't even check him out.
Yeah.
Aside from, like, you good?
Yeah.
You good, bro? Yeah.
It is a little weird.
I don't want to say I get it, because that would sound bad, but it's just like, you don't want to take your best goalie out of the game,
right.
especially at that juncture when I was it not the third period?
Yeah, it was. Yep.
And you don't want to do that.
Oh, we weren't coming back.
And
it's the bravado that still exists in the league. You know, yeah. I mean, just yeah. like you think about back even like 90s and 80s, where it's the same thing with enforcers. How like you know they're not gonna they're gonna yeah I'm fine, coach.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
Look, they've got major you know squishy head syndrome.
Right.
But it's just like, if Week from Home can see that he was not fine right after it, then
yeah.
you think somebody like the trainer, who's paid to see that,
yeah.
would say something.
What is that trainer, though, going to do in a Stanley Cup,
right.
you know, second round? Yeah.
Well, on the bright side, they do have Darling,
who
got
a chance
rode to the first series. So,
even if the trainer says something, is Q going to listen to him?
I think that was kind of Charlie's point, is that it shouldn't really be up to Q. Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't think it should be up to the coach, really, in that situation. I mean,
it's not. And actually, if you watched when they did the like 24/7 thing for the Winter Classic, there was a situation exactly like this, but with Andrew Shaw. And Shaw's on the bench going, I'm fine, I'm fine, I'm fine. And they dragged him off the ice.
Yeah.
And that's a skater. Yeah. I mean, it's a forward. You go down 11 forwards, whatever.
Right.
But you need to do that with every player,
yeah.
even if it's a goalie. And Quinville, to his credit, I mean, he said, yeah, they got to go check you out. And granted,
yeah.
like I said, it's a skater. It's a player
story.
That you could theoretically live without for 10 minutes, even though
yeah.
I mean, Shaw's a key
you.
Guy for them.
And even,
but,
even kind of in the Blackhawks, but one of the Blackhawks people I follow last night, he tweeted that the Blackhawks do have a previous history of not necessarily following the right steps with concussions. And he cited Dave Bolin, Nicholas Hjalmarsson, and Jonathan Toews. So I don't know the entire story, but
that all sounds right though, just from remembering their concussions for each of those players. Especially Hjalmarsson. How
he's a good athlete.
It's
close enough.
He's like Swedish or something. but no, I think he missed significant time.
I think so.
Ultimately.
Yeah.
The only thing I can think of when it comes to Blackhawks and concussion was the David Backus hit, where Backus got up and then somebody just shouted, wakey, wakey, Backus. that's the only thing I can remember Blackhawks related in a concussion. So like I said, I'm not totally in the know on that. But
yeah, it's just a weird situation, and it's not something you see a whole lot of, obviously. But yeah, I think that you know it's a little weird that goalies are the exception to the rule. So. Moving on from Corey Crawford, who, for whatever reason, is not nearly the save he was in the first round, which is disappointing. But on to Devan Dubnyk and, you know, his .892 save percentage in this round so far. You know, again, we don't want to jump into overreaction theater, but we want to talk about it a little bit. What do you guys think? I mean, he's obviously not as sharp as he was, you know, in 5 out of the 6 games against St. Louis, but should we be worried? I mean, is this anything that, you know, I don't think he's putting any kind of contract with the Wild in jeopardy at this point, but if this continues, would it, you think?
I'm not putting last night on him at all.
No, I'm not either. No. You know, because, I mean, the first goal was obviously Fluke City. And then the other two
made the save.
Right, exactly. It went off his knob. And then the second...
Beep!
Yeah. And then the second two, I mean, those were just really good shots by really good shooters, basically. I mean, there's nothing... Just,
yeah,
on
the sharp
own.
Shot was unreal.
Right, especially the way that he did that.
I don't want to call that the first goal fluky, because it was completely avoidable.
It was a two-on-zero, all
on Suter at the blue line.
He's got
this, you know, Selke candidate, you know, Hossa like coming at him, and he just does that he's not even facing Hossa. He does that lazy backhand pass, hoping it just jumps over his stick. Yep. Has anybody seen Hossa do that before?
Oh.
Yes, no, yes. Yes.
I thought you were asking
the answer
I thought
was
you were asking
yes.
a different question.
Because that's
mind.
What
yes.
he does. Yeah, that's what he does. He just pokes it around, and, you know, it's islands in the stream, and then he goes around.
Right.
And then, and it was just such a horrible play. And then on top of that, the fact that, so what happened? So he comes in, you know, Taves gets a shot off. Yes, it's incredible that it hit the knob.
He
knobbed it in. But Suter was what? Like two inches too
right.
late?
Yep. Yeah, you could have saved that goal.
You're telling me that Suter couldn't have gotten back a little bit quicker? You know,
well, especially after he just got his pocket picked. Yeah, I mean.
I don't know. He just has he has a rough game in general against Chicago. And that one, he was front and center.
I haven't been impressed with Suter at all, really, in the postseason. And I kind of noted that at the beginning of this series.
Yeah.
Because I was like, I want to see something more from him in this series. And it has just been.
Well, it's one of those things it's getting to the point where, he's playing badly, and I'm starting to listen to the people who are kind of bringing up the fact that he has to have something wrong with him.
Yeah.
He just doesn't look like himself. I mean, he's not the quickest guy to begin with.
From mid-season on, we kind of have had hints of this here and there. You know? I mean, he really hasn't been playing his game, you know, a lot of the season.
Yeah.
I mean, it's been it's been a pretty rough season for him, and
I think it's one of those things where we're going to bury him until this series is over or whatever.
That's true.
And then we're going to find out in 2 weeks that he's got, like, you know, two torn adductors in his hips and he can't skate at all, you know.
He's been having to have an attendant lace up his skates every game.
Yeah. I don't want to be, like, the resident player apologist, but he seems really off, like way too far off.
Yeah. I'm with you on that. But, you know, back to Doobie a little bit. Game one, I mean, game two, you know, the two goals that he actually allowed, you know, not much you can do there. I mean, those are wide open shots from really good players. But game one, you know, not his finest performance. Obviously, you were really hoping for an incredible bounce back. And you know, I just wrote for my article tomorrow, he's going to have to steal at least a couple of games. I mean, we're talking 2 to 3 maybe even 4 games for the Wild to come back in the series, because, you know, it's best of 5 at this point. And
I'd say, though, that I don't think it will require him to steal it, because it would just require him to play the way that he has played for us those 30-odd games on the stretch, and then several that were in the St. Louis series. It's just what he has shown that we can expect out of him. He needs to play that way for sure.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I think I'm repeating myself, but again, like, he's shown that he can bounce back.
Yeah.
He did it in the St. Louis series. So I'm optimistic.
Yeah.
And I think also some of it has to do with the team in front of him playing well.
But they play too.
Well, we saw that in game 4 of the last series too. When the team plays like garbage in front of him, it definitely trickles down. And that's, you know.
And that was stuff you saw pre-Dubnyk.
Right.
When they were getting lit up 7-1 every night.
I think if the Wild lose the series, it's not necessarily going to be because of him.
No.
You know,
no.
If they win the series, it might be because of him, but I don't think they'll lose it because of him.
Of the list of problems right now, Dubnyk's not even in the top 5.
Yeah.
Going into game 3. Dubnyk's not top 5. He might be hovering around 6 or 7.
Yeah. I mean, in the game 1, it was what concerns me, because especially with the game-winning goal, I mean, he didn't track it particularly well. I'm not, you know, absolutely crapping on him or anything. I think that he's been fantastic, obviously, but We need him to be absolutely on point, and we need Corey Crawford to not be on point, and he actually has been after a very shaky start against Nashville.
Or as Charlie would write, on fleek.
Yes.
What is? I don't want to know. Fleek job?
I don't even know. But
to riff on Giles' last point, the Wild have 99 problems, and Dubnyk ain't one.
Yeah.
Area Man's pop music references end in like 1999. that's me, I guess. Is that the last rap song?
I think that was more recent than that. Yeah. I think you're around the...
Okay, 2000. You're giving me 2000 on that
yeah,
one?
Yeah, 2002 maybe? Yeah. I don't Y2K. Even know. Somewhere around there. My Jay-Z timeline is a little fuzzy, but...
Jesus.
All right, so...
Train wreck.
Yeah, so...
Style.
That's, I think we've got a lot to be optimistic about still. I mean, down 2-0, it's easy to, just kind of fall back into the tornado shelter and just kind of cover your head and just kind of wait for it to be over. But I think there's a lot to be optimistic about. That being said, Game 3 is obviously, a huge game. I mean, they lose that and it's essentially over. They win that and it's still... very close to essentially being over. So it's we haven't seen them with their backs against the wall yet in this playoffs. They were led or tied in every game in St. Louis. So, maybe it's time we see this team with its back against the wall, because it worked well for them last year and historically even.
Worked well for them in the entire second half of the season.
Right, and that's also another point.
I mean, I think we all wrote about this before the playoffs, that it's never going to be a cakewalk. There's supposed to be adversity in the playoffs. This is it. And if they respond, then, it just makes the memory of what happens that much more special.
Right.
And if they don't, you fight again next year. You know what I mean?
Yep. Yeah, with a fairly similar team, from what we can tell. I mean, I don't think that...
I would imagine, yeah.
I don't think that the window is anywhere close to shut yet, so it's...
Well, they're still... I mean, the Wild are weird, because they've got a bunch of 31-year-olds.
Right.
And then a bunch of 22-year-olds.
Right.
They have nothing in between.
Yeah.
So at some point, we'll just lose half the team.
Well, they'll be around for another couple of years at least.
Well, a couple of them will be 45-year-olds.
All right.
Still
in our contract.
I think a lot of people do think the time is relatively now, though. I think you're right. The window is still open, even if it doesn't happen this season.
No, I agree with that.
But, I mean, the contract structure over the next several years could see a lot of change.
Yeah.
And then, once all those 30-somethings all leave at once.
Yeah. Yeah, well, to Charlie's point earlier, this is the best Wild team that we've ever seen.
Oh, for sure.
So, the window isn't closed yet, but this is also, the best shot that we've seen, since, 2003, the team wasn't obviously anywhere near this good. I mean, they made the Western Conference Finals, but
this
team wasn't anywhere near this good. So, it will be
the
disappointing.
The Wild were better than the team in 2003.
This year's Iowa Wild, though?
Kemper?
I don't know. anyway.
Well, they have Stu Bickle.
Yeah, that's very true. They do have Stu Bickle.
They also have 2003 Minnesota Wild Stephon Bayou.
Steve
is still around.
Bringing it all back.
So, since we're looking forward, or since we're talking about what we're looking forward to Game 3, can we talk about what I'm not looking forward to for Game 3?
Sure.
Because we lost the last podcast, and I had some stuff to get off my chest about Game 6 that never saw air.
I think so. I'd like to hear it again, because
I do not recall.
Well, what I'm not looking forward to in Game 3 is fan etiquette Wild fans have so aptly displayed this postseason.
Don't get me started.
Oh, are we talking? Like, does it rhyme with slave?
I'm setting odds in my head on the over-under of when fans will start chanting Crawford at the beginning
about
of the game.
About 30 seconds into the game.
Right.
Yeah,
and I'm
right
not exaggerating
now the odds on favorite is 15 seconds after puck drop.
Yep.
We're the most knowledgeable fan base in hockey, okay?
Yeah. But you
I stand by. Don't make me slap the table.
You want to taunt a guy who is pitching a shutout. That's what you do.
As Charlie kind of alluded to.
I think we can learn something from the Nashville fans. No, I'm just kidding. We can't. Because we've all been to college games.
They can all probably.
We're all excited to see where you were
yeah, that one just took me by surprise.
What the hell is the new guy talking about?
Yeah.
They can teach us how to wear cowboy hats?
Yeah.
So we just throw a catfish out on the ice? Is that it? it works with octopuses.
They just think it's any kind of seafood. They're not really sure what's going on.
We like catfish here, I guess.
Yeah. It's in the
I'm
South,
not sure if you just defended or confused all of Nashville. Like, what is he talking about?
I think both is fine.
I don't know if they're catfish people.
Okay, I mean, I have to be honest. If we have a listener from Nashville, we've clearly done something right.
It's true.
Do you guys remember that?
Though? One phone call, I can make that happen. My college roommate lives in Nashville.
Okay, it's fair. Hopefully he's not too offended.
I completely interrupted you.
Oh, no,
30,
that's fine.
40
that, was, ago. That was well worth it. That we needed that. And then the second point is the wave.
Stop.
Bleeping wave. And what happened
we
minutes
just did a
later, TJ Oshie scored the most junk goal you'll ever see in the playoffs, actually.
Well, that he actually scored, which is surprising enough.
Yeah, TJ Oshie scored in the playoffs. That doesn't happen. Don't do that. That looks bad, and bad things happen. Hockey gods don't take kindly to doing the wave.
I do remember this rant now because I was watching the game at home.
Yeah.
And I saw the wave, then I saw the goal, and my first thought was, Giles is going to like this.
Yeah. It worked me up into a proper lather as well because I just can't
stand
it.
They did the goddamn wave at the X for the away showing.
Yeah, I remember you said
game one
that.
Of the series one. People were doing the wave. So people were also, they were saying, let's go wild. We are in the X.
Ben's favorite.
Wild. We are watching the Wild players kind of around where the ice area is.
In the general vicinity.
It feels weird because it feels like you're at a home game.
Yeah.
And they're trying to chant. They're in St. Louis. They cannot hear you.
Yeah.
And then they did the wave.
Unless, they did that at the bar, too.
That screwed me up, though, too, because I started – I was pissed because, remember, like a minute left, Backus cross-checks Granlund. And I was like, why the hell would you ever put Granlund out there with a minute left? And some kind soul on Twitter was like, this is an away game.
Yeah.
They don't get to choose the lineup. Yeah. And I'm like, I'm sorry. I'm at the – this is weird for me, so.
That kind soul was actually part of our – I believe I remember that. That kind soul is actually part of the
Mincentric
family. Is Chris Boyd, who writes for Northern Pitch. He also writes for Hockey Wilderness. Very good guy. It was very nice of him.
Well, I think it's just a general idea. When you're up by a couple of goals, maybe just don't put Granlund out there anyway, even if you are on the road. Because he's going to get run by Cody
McLeod.
Or he's going to get run by David
Backus. He's got to put the first line out.
Right.
He's got to put, he doesn't choose that. He doesn't see, he's got to put Granlund out there for Captain Kangaroo to put Backus out.
Yo knows best.
Yo has to develop a heavy line. He just goes out there with nothing but, Coyle, Stewart, Niederreiter, Scandella, and whoever the fifth biggest guy on the team
is. Well, the thing about it is, if he actually does that, he can get fined for that.
Right.
I mean, just ask Bob Hartley.
Right.
Or Mark Crawford. Yeah. That's my second Mark Crawford reference of tonight.
That's not bad.
Killing
not
it.
All right, well, I think we've sufficiently ranted.
Are there any other annoying things that fans do that we like to talk about?
Oh, don't. Yeah, well, Giles and I can go all night.
Yeah.
That and jerseys.
Freezing.
Thankfully, when I go to the games, I don't tweet a whole lot because once the alcohol starts being consumed, I try to cut myself off for obvious reasons.
I can only do so much for you in that situation.
But yeah, that Sunday game was just, that was a lot to not say anything. So just please... If any Wild fans are listening, and I hope some of you are, please do the right thing. Don't do the wave.
Stop the wave.
Don't do the wrong thing.
And if you do, please report that to your nearest guest services attendant.
And to our one fan in Nashville.
Right.
His name is Dave, when I call him later. How's that catfish coming along?
Catfish.
Also, get new jerseys.
That too. All right. Well, I think that could probably wrap it up. From everybody at Wild Extra, including the crew, the biggest crew we've ever had, joining tonight from our special guest, Jared Mason, the typical Giles, and the typical Charlie, and the typical Ben. Typical. Thanks for listening, and hopefully we will talk to you next week when there's still relevant games being played. Until then, thanks for the time, thanks for listening, and we'll talk to you later.
Born and raised in South Detroit, he took the midnight train going anywhere. I'll sing her in a smoke.